1968, with still in use today.
Get to look at a couple objects.
Diameter telescope. We're talking about 107 inch, 82 inch, all that. We're talking about the diameter of the optics that are in there. And I'll get into more detail about that. But as you saw, we also call this the Harlan Smith Telescope. He was a very important person here at McDonald. Passed away in the early 90s. Anything at least 100 inches or bigger in diameter is considered to be a major research telescope for astronomy. So they use this every single clear night they can, even the 82 inch. Remember what was going on back in the 1960s that had to do with space? I wonder what that was. Everything, right? The space race split the cost with them on the telescope. So this was half NASA's telescope at the beginning until about the mid-1980s. By the way, back then, all this ran about $6 million to build. And I've heard if you built all this today, you'd be pushing $50 million. Yeah. So because of the cost, because telescopes are getting bigger and bigger all the time, you don't see too many telescopes built kind of like this traditional design, which I'm guessing that's what you thought you'd see out here, something like this big long tube. The one we're going to go to next, that telescope is four times the diameter of this one. So where do you see that thing? It looks completely different from this. They've changed the design to cut costs, which is what we'll get into when we get over there. Now, there's two main types of telescopes, and you've probably seen both types, like the ones with glass lenses on the front end. Maybe you hold on to it, you can fold them up, put them in your pocket, or the bigger ones you put on a tripod. But the ones that have a lens on the front, like a pair of binoculars does, those are called refractor telescopes. You refract, you bend the light to a focus. They make really good refractors, but the largest one you can manufacture in diameter is 41 inches. If it gets bigger than that, that glass on the top, it'll start to sag with gravity under its own weight. If you want to build something this big, you don't put a glass lens up there. It's hollow on the top end, for the most part. So here's a different kind of telescope. Instead of a glass lens on the top, this one has a glass mirror on the bottom, inside supported from underneath. So you wouldn't call this a refractor telescope. It's got a mirror. What would you call it? Reflector telescope, right. The mirror that's in there is 107 inches in diameter, and that's the casing that it sits in. So it gives you the glass weighs 4 tons. It was manufactured by Corning. Oh, most of you have heard of Corning before. Now, if we had the glass balanced, and just so you know, you're now standing underneath 160 tons of telescope. Start backing away so you can tell them that one. But notice the concrete piers connecting the two is this thing. That's called the polar axis, and it moves the telescope. It's hollow. So if you point mirror number three that I was talking about to mirror number four right up in there, you point starlight right down this tube, it goes through a hole in the floor. Down below us in the fourth floor is a high resolution spectrograph of some kind of view. Takes up most of the floor. Okay, I've been telling you about all this equipment, you know, all this, you know, these instruments and all. I haven't said anything about looking into an eyepiece. You notice that? How do you look at this thing? You know, take the duct tape off, stick your head in the hole. Well, you know, 100 years ago, yeah, we're doing that all the time. Looking through eyepieces, photographic equipment. Nowadays, we're sitting there. One screen has got the weather. They're constantly monitoring, but especially the carbon count because it's slow, humidity, and all that. Another screen has the internet. Another screen has the data collection from these instruments. And there's digital cameras built into this stuff. They can see what they're looking at here. It's mirrors, magnetograms, radio telescope. It's like different eyes looking at the sky. You learn more than just a picture or an eyepiece. Yes. Usually, most of the time, it's just one astronomer back there by himself. Sometimes they'll team up with other astronomers. I've seen several of them sharing their time. They meet together every 4 months, and they go through all of them. It's another effort. Avoid that. So that's what the floors do. This is where they usually do their work. This floor doesn't move, but that one goes up and down. Put in the catalog number, M42. Andromeda galaxy, M31, or whatever it is, NGC numbers and all that. And it's already got the coordinates in there, they tell it go, they press another button, and the telescope automatically goes where they told it to, in about 2 minutes or so. Well, I'm not going to do exactly that, but I am going to move the telescope for you. use this hand pan. Areas of space are known as stellar nurseries. And I'm going to tilt it that way and then back again. You can stay underneath it. So here we go. We're going to head towards the east. Let's go. Go. Here we go. Beast. Move that.
Screen.